This is the day you've been waiting for. The sun is shining, the birds are singing, and you know just what you want to do.
All you want to do is ride around Saddlery.
You know, one of the things that I try and get across to folks about natural horsemanship is it's not about a particular kind of clothes you wear, the hat you wear, the saddle you use on your horse, even the bit that you use with your horse. Hi, everybody. Rick Lamb here for the Horse Show. Natural horsemanship is more, to my way of thinking, about making a study of the horse's nature and committing to respecting that nature, working with it instead of against it, and communicating to the horse in ways that he instinctively understands. And that, to me, is what natural horsemanship is about. All that being said, you do see a surprising number of a particular kind of saddle among natural horsemanship clinicians. It's broadly called the Wade Tree Saddle, and it all goes back to a gentleman by the name of Cliff Wade. It's a little bit of a mysterious subject. We're going to get some of the blanks filled in today as I talk to Roger Allgeier, who is the owner of Brighton Feed and Saddlery in Brighton, Colorado. In addition to talking about the Wade Tree saddles that they make up there, he's going to also share with us some of the challenges of running a feed and tack store in modern times. And towards the end of our show, we're going to explore another topic of great interest to me, and that's hoof care. And I have with me Patty Stiller of the Equine Lameness Prevention Organization. She's carrying on the work of the great Gene Ovenek. And she has one of the best ways of explaining some of these key considerations about hoof care. And it has changed over the years. A lot of it built off of the early work with feral horses that Gene Ovenek did. All that's coming up on our show today. Remember our website, thehorseshow.com. Go there and become a member. You'll like it. I'm Rick Lamb. This is The Horse Show. And we'll be back. Stay with us. Hey, everybody, Rick Lamb here, and I have some great news to share with you today. ADM Animal Nutrition Premium Horse Feeds, the kind I use and recommend, are now available at True Value stores all across the U.S. You can order online and pick up at your local store. It's that easy, and there's never a shipping charge. Here's what I want you to do. Visit truevalue.com. You'll see a little search window there. Enter ADM, and it'll take you right to the page where you can order. The ADM premium horse products available through True Value are Senior Glow, Prime Glow, Ultra Fiber, Grow Strong Vitamin Mineral, and Forage First Horse Rewards. Remember, these are scientifically formulated products built around ADM's Forage First philosophy. And now you can get them through your local True Value store. You know, I didn't think ADM could do any more for the horse, but they've done it by partnering with True Value stores. Visit truevalue.com and search on ADM. ADM Animal Nutrition, doing what's right for the horse. You know, the time I spend with horses is the best part of my day, and I'm not going to put that at risk. That's why I look for products with the Farnam label. For more than 65 years, Farnam has been providing essential horse care products like fly control, deworming, grooming, hoof and leg care, wound care, leather care, stable supplies, and nutritional supplements. Find out for yourself what Farnam has to offer at farnamhorse.com. Farnam, your partner in horse care. The Hoof Cinch treats founder from a whole new angle.
It just forces that new growth along the bone, and it actually reattaches.
Unlike conventional founder treatments, the Hoof Cinch is applied to the outer hoof wall. It stabilizes the capsule and reduces pain immediately. In 12 to 16 weeks, horses can return to whatever they did before. Get the full story and watch a short video at hoofcinch.com. Don't give up on your foundered horse. Take the first step and learn about the Hoof Cinch at hoofcinch.com. Make watering your horses automatic and absolutely safe with the Bar A horse drinker. It's non-electric, and the bowl empties after every drink. That keeps the water warmer in winter and cooler in summer. Plus, you avoid breeding mosquitoes or algae. Right now, save 10% on the Bar A horse drinker when you mention Rick Lamb. 10%. Call 800-451-2230 or visit horsedrinker.com. The Bar A horse drinker. 800-451-2230 or horsedrinker.com.
Hard work comes with a lot of sweat. That's why there's new Wrangler Cool Vantage jeans. They keep you cool by wicking sweat five times faster. They keep you dry by pulling moisture to the outside where it dries faster. They keep you comfortable so you're less restricted all day long. new Wrangler Premium Performance Cool Vantage Jeans. The newest innovation in comfort.
And now, back to the Horse Show with Rick Lamb.
Welcome back, everybody, coming to you from Equifest of Kansas. If it doesn't sound like we're at a Horse Expo, it's because it was just a little bit too noisy out on the trade floor, and I wanted to sit and chat with my good friend Roger Allgeier from Brighton Feed and Saddlery, a legendary feed and tack store. Roger, welcome to the Horse Show.
Thank you, Rick. Appreciate it, and I appreciate being here.
Tell me a little bit about how you came to be the owner of Brighton Feed and Saddle.
Brighton Feed and Saddlery is now about 67 years old. A gentleman and his wife started it in 43 in Brighton. And Brighton at that time had a lot of dairies and feedlots. And Clyde ran it. Clyde Peterson was his name. And he ran the store about 25 years. And then he retired. He had some health problems and was getting elderly, and he retired. And then there was a couple quick flips. Probably within 3 years, there was two more owners. And my wife and I were living in Arizona at the time, and we got a call from a friend that said, hey, come look at this store. We know you're looking for something to do. So we flew up, and we looked at the store, and flew back to Arizona and made some quick arrangements. And on January 2nd of 1973, we opened the door under our name.
Wow. It's going on 40 years.
38 years.
Yeah,
we finished 38 years.
Man, did you ever think you'd be doing it this long?
We said we'd give it 5 years, and if we liked it, we'd stay, and if not, we'd go back to Arizona. And we didn't draw our first deep breath till 10 years. It's gone by so fast.
Wow. What are the challenges of running a feed and saddlery in modern times?
Well, I think one of the biggest challenges we have are employees. That's a tough deal, and we've had as many as 24 employees. We have about 14 right now, and that's always a challenge. We have one of the best crews right now that I've ever had, some of the most dedicated people, and we like it. Obviously, some of the other challenges today as we speak would be the economy. It's affected us. It's tough, but we're hanging in there, and we've learned to work leaner and promote harder. And then the competition from the internet is pretty tough also.
Yeah.
So we learn. We have a website. We learn where to compete, and we've let some areas go where we just feel we can't. So we just go the direction the Lord sends us.
You know, it's funny. I live in Arizona, which isn't, you know, terribly far from where you are. But I've always been aware. I can't even remember the first time I heard of Brighton Feed and Saddlery. So it's a name that's been out there. You obviously have done a good job of creating awareness of what you do. And I've always thought of it as being a place to go to get traditional cowboy saddles.
Thank you. That's where we do try to promote. Most saddles are a commodity item. You can
now, what do you mean by that when you say they're a commodity item?
There's 50 companies that make saddles, and whether you buy that saddle from a place in Connecticut or Brighton, it's basically the same saddle. It just becomes who's got that saddle at the best price.
Right.
We started a saddle company about 23 years ago because I needed a look and a quality that I couldn't find. And so we started McCall Saddle Company about 23 years ago and developed that. And we did have a few dealers around the country because obviously to keep our saddle makers busy, we could make more saddles than Brighton Saddlery could sell. But we've always tried to brand ourselves with quality saddles. And I do carry several brand names. We carry Martin Saddles and we carry Circle Y, and they're great saddles. But we've always liked saddles that lean toward being custom made, and we make a lot of custom saddles for customers. Mm-hmm. If they ask for a certain look, certain seat, certain tooling patterns, we can do it.
When I think of the McCall saddle, you know from past discussions, I'm kind of enamored with the Wade saddle. I just have two of them now. But I've always been aware of, I've thought of McCall as being a great source for Wade saddles. Talk a little bit about the mystique, I suppose, of the Wade saddle.
Well, one question that I get over the years is, when is the fad for weighed saddles going to pass? And I say, oh, in about 150 years, because a weighed type saddle came out of Mexico in the late 1700s, early 1800s, as the Mexican vaquero saddle, and in California and up the West Coast developed into the weighed as we know it today. I got interested in wades when I started attending Buck Brannaman clinics and started to learn what the true wade was. There's wade saddles and then there's true wade saddles. Mm-hmm. Most companies have a slick fork with a wood post horn and they're called a wade. But a true wade is almost a philosophy, the way it sets the rider and sets the horse. It's the Western version of the dressage saddle.
Which I would think of that as being a little more close contact.
Maybe absolutely.
Down, sitting a little bit tighter onto the horse. And
yes, it's a close contact, and you ride straight up in it, just kind of like Tom and Bill Dorrance did and Ray Hunt.
Well, you know probably more than most people about actually the name Wade, where that came from, who that refers to.
Well, I got this story from Bill Dorrance, Dreck. He was on one horse, and I was on another, and we were visiting in a Joe Walters roping clinic that Bill came to help with. And Bill told me that his brother Tom was still a fairly young man, and this would have been probably in the early 30s. And he liked a saddle that his neighbor Cliff Wade had. And he asked Cliff where he got the saddle, and he said it was made by Hamley up in Pendleton, Oregon. And they were from that country. So Tom went up to Hamley's and asked about developing a tree like Cliff Wade had, but wanted some different changes. And I'm not sure what those changes were at that time, but Hamley said, you know, Tom, we're just so busy. I don't know if I can get those changes made. There's a good tree maker up in Portland. So Tom went up there and he looked at the trees and he came back to Hamley and he said, I don't care how long it takes. I want you to make me this saddle like Cliff Wade had, but make these following changes.
Were the changes, they weren't to the tree though, were they? Were they kind of superficial to the leather part or something?
No, it would be to the tree.
To the tree itself.
Yeah,
okay.
And I'm not sure if he, at that time, he made the Wade horn, the bigger wood post horn, or, you know, the original Wade's only had a 3-inch cantle. Today, 4 inches is more, is more standard. But possibly a different bar pattern that would fit a horse a little different.
Okay.
And so anyway, Tom got his tree. He went up there, Hamley called him, and Tom went up and got his tree, and they said, we're going to call this the Dorrance tree. And Tom said, no, I don't need my name on it. It's, you know, Cliff designed it. It's his saddle. I just made a few changes. We'll continue it to call it the Wade tree. So that was the beginning of what everybody calls the Wade saddle. And there are some tree companies that actually have one called the Cliff Wade. But that was the beginning of it from about, I'm going to say, probably the very early 30s.
Mm-hmm. You know, we always wondered who Tom Dorrance, who influenced Tom Dorrance in his horsemanship. And we know that he had a relationship with Cliff Wade, and Cliff was a bit older. I've heard it's 20 years. I don't know that for a fact. But it's possible that Cliff Wade was somebody who impressed on Tom Dorrance. I'm talking with Mr. Roger Allgeier, owner of Brighton Feed and Saddlery. When we get back, how he has adapted the traditional Wade tree saddle for women. I'm Rick Lamb. This is The Horse Show. Stay with us. Hey everybody, Rick Lamb here. For me, Travel In Corrals makes the best portable corral system on the market, and here's why. First, the panels are easy to handle. They're 7 feet long and just 15 pounds. Anyone can set up a Travel In Corral. 6 panels make a 13-foot round pin, 8 panels make an 18-foot round pin. Second reason I'm crazy about Travel In Corrals is how these metal panels are made. They're notched and welded, and they hook together with a 4-foot steel rod. They're horse safe, thoroughly tested, and they come with a lifetime guarantee for the original owner. But hey, don't take my word for it. See for yourself. Watch an introductory video at travelincorrals.com. That's travel, the letter in, corrals.com. You'll get the backstory on the horse people behind these highly practical portable corral panels. And if you mention me, Rick Lamb, you'll save $50 if you order. Remember, 7 feet long, 15 pounds, and a lifetime guarantee. Check them out. Travel In Corrals. Travel, the letter in, corrals.com. Fact of the matter is, nailed-on metal horseshoes are a tradition, and a lot of horses simply don't need them. Hey everybody, Rick Lamb here. Here's what I suggest. If you like the idea of barefooting your horse, go ahead and try it. But also do this. Get yourself some good all-purpose hoof boots to protect your horse's bare feet when you ride. I recommend the Simple Boot from Cavallo. Simple boots are exactly what the name implies. They're uncomplicated, easy to use, lightweight, durable. When you put them on, they stay on. With Simple Boots on your horse, you can walk, trot, canter, jump, go through water, go through mud. Whatever you're doing, the Simple Boot stays on and your horse stays comfortable. Remember, there are different stresses on your horse's bare feet when you ride him. Hoof boots are an essential part of the barefooting protocol. See the Cavallo Simple Boot in action and learn how to choose the right size at simpleboot.com. You'll also see the five very attractive colors available, starting at just $99.95 with free shipping. The Simple Boot from Cavallo, simpleboot.com. Welcome back to the Horse Show, everybody. I'm Rick Lamb. My guest is Roger Allgeier of Brighton Feed and Saddlery. And we were just talking about the Dorrance brothers, Tom and Bill.
There was a third brother named Fred, and both Bill and Tom have mentioned that they have all felt that Fred was the best horseman of the three.
Yeah.
But Fred was killed in a river crossing horseback one time, yeah. And he didn't live to be too old a man.
Well, there were passel of kids in the Dorrance family, I think four brothers and a couple sisters. But anyway, it's a fascinating story, and the Wade saddle, I think the Wade tree, wasn't there like a, they put a year on it at some point. It's like the 58 Wade or something.
Right. I'm not sure who redesigned the Wade. It was probably Hamley in 1958. So the term 58 Wade became a buzzword in a Wade saddle. Yeah. And when I was designing a new saddle for McCall, I'd originally come with a Wade that I felt, since it was an entry type saddle for a lot of people going to clinics that hadn't ridden Wades, I raised the front a little bit to an 8-inch and I changed the horn down a little bit so it was not so intimidating. Mm-hmm. Until I got ready for my very traditional Wade in a year or two. And I kept trying to think of a name for this Wade, and it was 1997. And I thought, my gosh, it's going to be 1998 till I get this tree redesigned. And I thought, that's it. So I called that one the 98 Wade, mm-hmm. not playing on the 58 Wade,
right.
But an improved version. So we still have the 98 Wade.
Do you also have a Lady Wade?
My wife designed the Lady Wade. We were coming back from a show, and even she and I differ on which show. I was thinking it was the Amarillo WRCA, and she's thinking it was a trade show. But anyway, on the way back, she said, Roger, these women are asking for Wade saddles so they can go to clinics, but they don't want a 45-pound saddle. Right. You know, I can figure that out. Get your pencil out and let's talk. One of the things we did was remove the flat plate rigging, mm-hmm. and build it into the skirt.
Okay.
But I wanted it to look traditional, so we dropped the shape of the skirt. So from a distance, it has that profile. Mm-hmm. The other thing we did was take out the inside, the full stirrup leather, and attach the stirrup leather to the top of the fender. Mm-hmm. And that's been done a lot over the years, but that eliminates weight and bulk, so you could get a closer contact to the horse.
Now, there's been some talk about how a woman's, well, not some talk, it's a medical fact, a woman's pelvis is shaped differently from a man's. Did you do anything in the ground seat there to accommodate the difference?
We did. If you can picture sitting on a park bench, your pin bones are supported. Mm-hmm. And if you sit on a round sewer pipe, your pin bones have to rotate to get support. There's a pretty fine line between straddling a square base, which would support your pin bones, and a round base, which would allow your legs to drop fairly rapidly. They have to drop gradually and rapidly from the seat. So we worked pretty long and hard to get that transition. So the seat in our Lady Wade is slightly rounded, mm-hmm. but the transition from the seat to the stirrup leather is, the best way I can describe it, is rapid but gradual.
Gradual. Your goal was to make it a lighter saddle. Were you successful?
We got it down to about 32 pounds. That's which takes good. About 10 to 13 pounds from the traditional Wade.
which makes a real difference. Of course, once you start leaving your breast collar on and you know the back cinch and everything, that weight starts creeping up, and before you know it, you got a pretty heavy rig there. So, you know, even us big guys get tired of throwing that 50-pound rig over the back of a horse.
Well, I've had couples come in and buy two of them. And
I was going to ask you if guys ever hopped on it.
Absolutely.
And, we sell a lot of them. And it still feels okay to them?
Right. And we tell them, hers is the Lady Wade, yours is the Wade Light. same tree.
Well, what else? Obviously, you're a feed store as well. How's the feed business these days?
Feed business is good. It's very competitive. And with commodities jumping all over the place, every time corn and soybeans and the other commodities take a huge jump, feed goes up. And then when the market comes back down, the feed does not. We're all in the same crunch. Yeah. And also, the quality of feed, such as the major companies, understanding the digestibility of protein and things like the probiotics and the chondroitin sulfate, the joint issues, a lot of that's built in, so the price of feed goes up. But it's also made less of a demand for supplements, so that kind of balances out.
Do you sell hay as well?
Yes, we sell.
I'm always very sympathetic, I guess, to our feed store where we get our hay because, you know, the hay quality seems to vary from one load to another. And sometimes we get a great load of hay and the horses just love it. And other times it's kind of chopped up and it's just kind of dirty and they kind of turn their nose up at it. But I never complain about it because I know it must be very tough to get consistent quality hay. Is that true?
It's true. I work with a local producer on grass hay and grass mix. And, of course, you're down in Phoenix where sometimes your grass hay is just Bermuda. You don't get
probably a
lot of choice in your grass hays. Up here, we can get mountain hay, which has Timothy, and then we can get local hay, which might be Orchard or Brome up in the Front Range of Colorado. And then we produce our own alfalfa. I have a small place and produce our own alfalfa. 2 years ago, we could not get a good cut in the hay. It rained 3 days of every week all summer. So obviously, it's tough to get a consistent quality. But this one producer I use for my grass and grass alfalfa mix is doing a very nice job. So we're fairly consistent. There's enough producers in our area that customers come to us for a few bales. But if somebody gets a bad bale, I say, just tie up and bring back what you haven't used because I can feed it to my cattle.
Yeah.
And we'll replace it. We don't argue. Yeah.
You're a man that obviously enjoys what he's doing. You've always got a big smile on your face. You always seem to be in a good mood. And it's been a delight meeting you. To me, Brighton Feed and Saddlery is kind of legendary. And I was so happy to find you such an accessible, regular guy. I mean, it's been fun.
Well, the same here. I mean, I've heard of Rick and I've seen some of your productions, and you're a great guy to sit down and talk with.
Well, thank you. Well, we'll definitely be driving up your way next time we're in Denver. We've got plenty of reasons to head on up I-25, so we'll just make a stop at Brighton on the way.
We're only about 20 minutes north of Denver, so we're there 6 days a week.
All right, sir. Thank you so much. Roger, the website, in case you'd like to learn more, is brightonsaddlery.com, BRIGHTONSADDLERY.com. My guest has been Roger Allgeier. Roger, thank you again.
Thanks a lot, Rick. Enjoyed it.
Still to come, if you're like most of us, you've agonized about whether to put shoes on your horse's feet or let him go barefoot. Well, Patty Stiller will address all of that when the Horse Show Live continues. I'm Rick Lamb. Don't you dare go away. Hey, everybody, Rick Lamb here. For me, Travel In Corrals makes the best portable corral system on the market, and here's why. First, the panels are easy to handle. They're 7 feet long and just 15 pounds. Anyone can set up a travel-in corral. 6 panels make a 13-foot round pin. 8 panels make an 18-foot round pin. Second reason I'm crazy about travel-in corrals is how these metal panels are made. They're notched and welded, and they hook together with a 4-foot steel rod. They're horse safe, thoroughly tested, and they come with a lifetime guarantee for the original owner. But hey, don't take my word for it. See for yourself. Watch an introductory video at travelincorrals.com. That's travel, the letter N, corrals.com. You'll get the backstory on the horse people behind these highly practical portable corral panels. And if you mention me, Rick Lamb, you'll save $50 if you order. Remember, 7 feet long, 15 pounds, and a lifetime guarantee. Check them out. Travel in Corrals. Travel, the letter N, corrals.com. Hey everybody, Rick Lamb here, and I have some great news to share with you today. ADM Animal Nutrition Premium Horse Feeds, the kind I use and recommend, are now available at True Value stores all across the U.S. You can order online and pick up at your local store. It's that easy, and there's never a shipping charge. Here's what I want you to do. Visit truevalue.com. You'll see a little search window there. Enter ADM, and it'll take you right to the page where you can order. The ADM premium horse products available through True Value are Senior Glow, Prime Glow, Ultra Fiber, Grow Strong Vitamin Mineral, and Forage First Horse Rewards. Remember, these are scientifically formulated products built around ADM's Forage First philosophy. And now you can get them through your local True Value store. You know, I didn't think ADM could do any more for the horse, but they've done it by partnering with True Value stores. Visit truevalue.com and search on ADM. ADM Animal Nutrition, doing what's right for the horse.
If you're like me, you need a pretty good reason to sit in front of a TV set these days. Hi everybody, Rick Lamb here. RFD TV is that reason. Finally, there's a network for people like you and me, people who care about the rural lifestyle, about livestock and tradition. RFD TV brings you family-friendly programming that entertains and educates and never ever offends. Every week you see the icons of country music with Ralph Emery, Crook and Chase, and Marty Stewart. You get some of the top horsemen in the world like Clinton Anderson, Chris Cox, Craig Cameron, and the Pirellis. And you get farm news and special features. Oh yeah, you get me too. So join me and the millions of other RFD TV viewers. Call your satellite or cable provider and ask for RFD TV, rural America's most important network. It's TV we can all be proud of. To learn more, visit rfdtv.com or give them a call at 615-227-9292.
Thank you for listening to The Horse Show with Rick Lamb. If you have a question, request, or comment, we want to hear from you. Our fax number is area code 602-279-0980. Or if you would like to email us, the address is lambemail@aol.com. Now, back to Rick.
Welcome back, everybody. Coming to you from Equifest of Kansas. Now, we are not actually out on the trade floor as I usually am doing my interviews. It was actually a little too noisy there today from all the activity. So we've snuck into a back room here to have a chat with Patty Stiller about the Equine Lameness Prevention Organization. Patty, welcome to the Horse Show.
Thank you for having me.
You are carrying on the work started by my friend Gene Ovnik, correct?
Yes, I'm part of a very large organization that's carrying on his work. He sort of passed the reins on to a lot of different people now, and we're all promoting his principles and all the new research that we're doing into the farrier community.
The thing that I love about Gene, he's kind of a almost a mythical figure now to people in the hoof care industry by all the research that he did with the wild horses and, you know, to really put some science behind some of the things that we're doing, that they were doing with hoof care. Can you kind of give us a little bit of a brief bio of Gene and how he came to be sort of the guru of hoof care?
Sure. Back in the 1980s, I believe 1986 and 87, Gene did a feral horse, wild horse study, just looking at the wear patterns on wild horse feet. And he found some interesting data that opened a lot of questions as to what we might be able to do for our domestic horse feet to help them be sounder and have a more solid foot and have less lameness problems. That has long evolved now into a lot of research that's coming in from around the world, from those windows that he opened up and those questions he brought up, and on research specifically on domestic horse feet. And the Equine Lameness Prevention Organization now is doing research studies to help get data to help farriers who are working on our non-feral friends to keep them sounder and help prevent lameness. And Gene's been greatly involved in a lot of that. He's now sort of stepping out of the limelight and allowing the organization and its board of directors and people from around the world to take over this work.
You know, the study he did with the feral horses is something that we documented in one of my books, The Revolution in Horsemanship, and I was fascinated by it, and I've interviewed him on radio a number of times about this. And as I recall, correct me if I'm wrong about this, there were, I think, four different control groups, or at least a number of different control groups from fairly dramatically different environments. Some that lived on kind of rocky terrain, and others that lived in sandy soil and so forth. And the idea was to see what the natural wear patterns were on those feral horses who had very different lives.
Yes, there were actually three different groups. And they were from a very hard rocky environment, a softer environment, and a very soft sandy environment. And the interesting data that he gathered back then was that although the heels were different on these feet because of the ability of the heel to wear away, the toe wear was in almost exactly the same spot in every group of horses. And that simply opened the door to look at why. And there is a misconception now that what we do and promote is all about the front of the foot and the toe. But we've discovered that it's more about the back of the foot, because our horses are living in different environments and we're putting shoes on them. A lot of times the back of the foot isn't dealt with in a manner that keeps that foot healthy and functioning. So now that's kind of where we go, is the back of the foot first and the toe is sort of secondary.
You know, the interesting thing to me about Gene's work, of course, he developed the Natural Balance shoe, and I'll ask you to explain that, what's different about that, in a moment, but also the Natural Balance trim. And in the world of, you know, the whole debate about whether horses should even be wearing shoes, Gene managed to sort of live in this very reasonable middle ground that I always really appreciated with him, because I felt that sometimes people became kind of closed-minded about what horses needed, all from the best intentions. They want to do what's right for the horse, but they didn't recognize that some horses have different requirements than others. Can you kind of speak to that whole thing?
Yeah, in fact, I'm speaking on that here at the event. I have a workshop on that very subject about using common sense and having a set of guidelines to decide if your horse needs shoes or not. Natural Balance is not a shoe, and Gene is the first one to say that. It's kind of unfortunate they named the shoe that, because Natural Balance is a set of principles about balancing the foot so the internal structures can work in the most healthy manner. And that applies whether the horse is shod or barefoot. Mm-hmm. So when we do shoe horses, we like to use principles that are going to keep the foot healthy and not cause a lot of the damage that a lot of the barefoot people are complaining about, that they think all shoes cause. And we know that all shoes do not cause that. In fact, we can totally prevent it if they're shod in a manner that addresses the needs of the foot.
One of the interesting things that came out of the feral horse study was observing the toe and the way it naturally wore, and how that, and the implications of that wear to breakover. Can you talk a little bit about where a wild horse typically has breakover?
Sure. And in fact, a wild horse and any domestic horse that has a chance to wear his foot, if he gets enough use and he's not got a shoe on that's preventing it, will wear to the same place. There's an anatomical structure, and it's a denser area of sole that grows off the end of the coffin bone, and the toe will roll right to the top edge of that sole. We call it a sole callus. It's not really a callus, but it will roll right to that point on every single foot. That's the most dense part of the sole. There's an anatomical reason for it, and there are mechanical leverage reasons for it. Reducing leverage around a horse's foot is one of the key factors in keeping them sound.
He's been able to continue in the Natural Balance shoe as well, because when you look at it, you see that it looks different from a typical keg shoe.
Yes, it looks a bit different. It's more of a rolled toe. It's got a rolled edge all the way around. It's not a square shoe. People think it is. Your eye kind of makes you think that. He's also developed, since that original shoe came out, to help put these principles on a horse's foot, he's come out with a number of different shoes of different designs to accommodate horses that we're asking to do very unnatural things, you know, reiners and barrel racers and dressage horses. And so there are shoes to accommodate all of that that still apply the principle, but the shoes all look slightly different.
Mm-hmm. Do they all have that breakover point slightly back from the toe?
It's not so much back from the toe as it is forward from the center of their coffin joint. And
okay.
It's a misconception, because not all horses have excess toe. And so they don't all have toe that's become distorted. And only the ones that have toe that has become distorted are going to have a shoe set off the toe. So a lot of the shoeing we do, the shoe is set right at the end of the foot, but the foot is not distorted. And that's what we try to clarify to people that we're not setting back the shoe, we're centering the shoe around the internal parts of the foot. And that's where our research has come in, doing radiographic studies. We've recently done a study on the widest part of the foot and know that we can use that, and farriers can use that as a map to center their shoeing, no matter what shoe they're using, around the joints inside the foot.
There's another thing that came out of that study, as I recall, and it seems to me that Gene called them pillars. Does that ring a bell?
Yes, there is an anatomically more dense area that runs down at about the toe corners. You could call them 2 o'clock and 10 o'clock on the foot. And it's actually more dense material in that part of the foot. And it corresponds, not coincidentally, with the point at which the toe is going to roll. Mm-hmm. And horses that have a chance to develop those pillars, both barefoot horses always have them. Some domestic horses are a little less dense, but they do develop later on if you allow it.
Aren't there pillars set back also? Aren't there some more towards the back as well?
Some are longer, and they start in the front of the pillar on some feet starts, they all start in the same place. Mm-hmm. But some continue back around the foot a little farther, and that would be on basically your club feet. Certain feet that aren't quite normal might have a more of an upright foot, might have a pillar that's a little longer and goes farther back.
What I was thinking, and I need to refresh my memory on this, but in my mind I was seeing actually four places, and that it was kind of between the two pillars on the side that often you would see a wear, kind of chip out a little bit there naturally on the side.
Yes, because the sole of every foot has a slight arch to it, some more than others. Mm-hmm. There will also be a corresponding amount of chipping, normal chipping, and wear that's more on the sides of the foot, creating a slight arch. Some feet are flatter, some feet have more, but it's there.
My horse is barefoot. I'm not a barefoot apologist or anything. It's just that in my case, she does fine without shoes. And there have been times that I've ridden her fairly hard over some fairly rocky terrain, and I've observed what that does, the wear patterns on her feet. And over the course of several days, they start looking just like one of those Mustang hooves with a little bit of chipping out on the sides and, of course, the roll on the end. So it seems to me like if we allow horses to wear normally, they will kind of form their own hoof.
Yes.
Isn't that kind of part of the principle here?
Yes, absolutely. And a lot of the big movement toward barefoot that has been in this country now for the last decade or so, they've noticed that by taking shoes off, they allow that foot to remodel and reform itself into a more healthy shape. And what we do with the Equine Lameness Prevention Organization is try to teach farriers that there are ways, if we need to shoe a horse, and we don't shoe every horse, but if we need to, that there's ways to accommodate those things and allow that foot to be in a healthy functioning form, even though it is wearing a shoe.
My guest is Patty Stiller of Equine Lameness Prevention Organization. And when we return, the issue of discomfort. How much should we expect the horse to tolerate? How much is humane in his hoof care? Stay with us. We'll be right back.
The Horse Show with Rick Lamb is a copyrighted production of Lamb Chop Studios, Phoenix, Arizona. Unauthorized use is strictly prohibited.
The Hoof Cinch treats founder from a whole new angle.
It just forces that new growth along the bone, and it actually reattaches.
Unlike conventional founder treatments, the Hoof Cinch is applied to the outer hoof wall. It stabilizes the capsule and reduces pain immediately. In 12 to 16 weeks, horses can return to whatever they did before. Get the full story and watch a short video at hoofcinch.com. Don't give up on your foundered horse. Take the first step and learn about the Hoof Cinch at hoofcinch.com.
That's music to my ears. Hi, I'm Pat Pirelli.
And I'm Linda Pirelli. If you love everything about horses, the way they look, the way they sound, even the way they smell, well, you're among friends at RFD-TV.
RFD-TV has the most horse programs of any network on television, every day, all year long.
Take Pirelli Natural Horsemanship, for example. Each week, you'll learn how you and your horse can become recreation for each other, how training can be shaped to the personality or horsenality of your horse,
and how you can reach your horsemanship goals.
RFD-TV brings you family-friendly programming that educates, entertains, and inspires. It's TV we can all be proud of.
And it's available on satellite and cable systems throughout the country. To learn more, visit rfdtv.com.
Or call 615-227-9292.
RFD-TV and Pirelli Natural Horsemanship.
We're teaming up to make life better for you and your horse.
Make watering your horses automatic and absolutely safe with the Bar A horse drinker. It's non-electric, and the bowl empties after every drink. That keeps the water warmer in winter and cooler in summer. Plus, you avoid breeding mosquitoes or algae. Right now, save 10% on the Bar A horse drinker when you mention Rick Lamb. 10%. Call 800-451-2230 or visit horsedrinker.com. The Bar A horse drinker. 800-451-2230 or horsedrinker.com. You know, the time I spend with horses is the best part of my day, and I'm not going to put that at risk. That's why I look for products with the Farnam label. For more than 65 years, Farnam has been providing essential horse care products like fly control, deworming, grooming, hoof and leg care, wound care, leather care, stable supplies, and nutritional supplements. Find out for yourself what Farnam has to offer at farnamhorse.com. Farnam, your partner in horse care.
Every month, there's hands-on advice from the pros in Horse and Rider, the how-to magazine for Western riding. Call now and get 2 years for the price of one, just $24. 1-800-829-3340.
In February's Horse and Rider, you'll learn technique on giving injections to the needle-shy horse, tips for tricking out your stall setup at shows, and advice on hosting a summer horse camp. Subscribe to Horse and Rider today and save. Call 1-800-829-3340. The wait is over. You can now get the audio version of Human to Horseman. 5 hours on four standard audio CDs, just $24.95. Visit thehorseshow.com to order.
The Horse Show with Rick Lamb is here every week at this time. So tell a friend.
We do appreciate the help. Folks, just tell people about our website. That's the simplest and best thing you can do, thehorseshow.com. My guest is Patty Stiller of Equine Lameness Prevention Organization.
So what would be situations in which you would think shoeing would be a good idea?
The no-brainers, I call sometimes therapeutic issues, where mm-hmm. a horse has a hoof disease or injury that is severe enough that he just can't be managed in hoof boots or barefoot or can't heal. And those would be your severe laminitis, severe founder, fractures, things like that.
Navicular.
But some performance disciplines, you're just really not going to go out there and win those ribbons and make that money unless that horse is wearing a shoe that assists him in a way of perhaps traction. A reining horse, for example, is not going to make those winning slides without the proper sliding plates on at least his hind feet. A barrel racing horse in certain arenas is not going to have enough traction to get that hundredth of a second to win that money. So there's certainly instances. And there are horses that just have not developed the foot to be able to go barefoot comfortably. And I'm not ever a believer in causing a horse pain just to get him out of shoes. Some horses don't have the genetics. It's not all environment. There's some genetics involved. We've bred the good foot right out of some of our horses, and the internal structures that are supposed to be there aren't there. They're not as strong as they should be. Those horses need an assist with shoeing.
That's a very reasonable, kind of humane middle ground, it sounds to me like. And that's how I always think of Gene, as being like the voice of reason amidst all of this. But I want to go back to something that you just said about never causing a horse discomfort. Now, I know that one of the leading schools of thought about barefooting says that there's going to get to this good place where a horse has a good, well-developed bare foot, there's going to be some time when he's a bit ouchy. Because he has to, it's kind of like us, if I wanted to build up my feet to go barefoot, the first few days, my feet would be pretty tender.
Well, now a little tiny bit of ouchiness, a little tiny bit of tenderness for a few days is not, in my opinion, inhumane. Unfortunately, there are some barefoot practitioners around the country, and some have come from out of the country, who are promoting that it's okay for a horse to be in even extreme pain for long periods of time, or moderate pain for long periods of time. And pain in itself can cause damage to a horse's foot. It induces chemical reactions in the foot, which can reduce the circulation and actually cause damage. And I have seen horses that were, people attempted to get them barefoot, and the horse was in extreme pain long enough that they actually caused full-blown laminitis and foundered them. And I've known personally of a few horses that ended up dead because of that. Mm. And that's the extreme obvious end of the story. But we have to use some reason as to how much discomfort is okay. And that's why all these hoof boots that are on the market have been developed. And they're a great tool. If the horse is fine in his everyday environment, but he's not okay on the trails, you put boots on him. And
sure.
It's all common sense, and that's what we try to teach, is common sense and using your head.
Okay, well, let's talk a little bit about the Equine Lameness Prevention Organization as an organization. First of all, this is a 501c3 nonprofit public charity. Why was it organized that way?
It was organized that way so we could do more for the horse community, mm-hmm. and also so that we could get donations that could go all directly to research. We do farrier clinics and schools. We have a farrier school and a trimming classes, and all of what would be profits from that go right back into the organization to help pay for veterinarians, that help with our research studies, to buy equipment. We have some big future plans, and we need funds for that. The biggest future plan that we're working toward is to have an equine rehabilitation and research center with full facilities and veterinarians and x-ray rooms and all that. We have our conference coming up in October, the International Lameness Prevention Conference in October in Colorado. We have a speaker that we're flying in, Dr. Chris Pollitt. He's a leading laminitis researcher from Australia. He's going to be our featured speaker there. We also have another research project coming up that we're working on giving farriers some guidelines to achieve accurate medial lateral or side to side balance in the foot. That's always been a debatable topic, and we want to do another x-ray radiographic study to give farriers some accurate guidelines to balance feet mm-hmm. internally. That's the next thing on our list. And then we've got the conferences, and we've got the research center that we want to build. We're putting together funds to buy a digital x-ray machine. Those mm-hmm. are quite a bit of money. So we're setting aside funds for that.
You know, we touched on this just a little bit earlier, that wild horses and domestic horses aren't always quite the same. We have sometimes bred changes into horses' feet that are not necessarily in their best interest. How big an issue is that to people who would say, well, Gene's work was with wild horses, domestic horses are a different animal?
It has always been an issue with people that don't fully understand what Gene has done and what we do with the organization. They believe, because Gene's work was, 25 years ago, and they don't realize how much of the work since then has been done just on domestic horse hooves. And I would say that the vast majority of all the research now, including the research we do, is on domestic horse feet. What the wild horses did was just raise questions. Why are all the toes worn in this manner? And why are the distances between the frog and the end of the toe so short? Things like that. Since then, all this research is coming in about the insides of the foot and the domestic foot and the anatomy and how we can best, you know, help domestic horses. It's come a long way. We're not trying, and don't ever expect, to make a domestic horse into a feral horse. It's mm-hmm. it's not going to happen.
Do you think, because of kind of an increased awareness, that we will start seeing an evolution back in a positive way to breeding good feet back onto horses?
I certainly hope so. I don't know if it'll happen because of the demands of the show ring particularly. Mm-hmm. They're looking for specific traits that don't necessarily have to do with soundness, unfortunately. Mm-hmm. Although if they keep breeding horses with poor quality feet, we now have the tools to prevent the common lamenesses such as navicular syndrome and navicular disease that occur in those breeds by understanding what's going on with those hooves and being able to attack these issues from a very young age in these horses. We can hopefully, I'd like to see that whole problem end in my lifetime.
Yeah. Do you think education, just kind of educating the public, creating a grassroots almost sort of a movement back to a better foot, think there's any possibility for that?
I really hope so. I really do, because we know what the weaknesses are in some particular breeds and some types of horses, thoroughbreds particularly. There are cartilage structures that just aren't there that should be there. And if they can recognize that and stop breeding these poor-footed mares and stallions, and just because they did well in the halter ring, for example, right. if they would just be more aware and more concerned about the breed, I hope we can get them to start putting a better foot on them.
Well, in just sort of, I suppose, wrapping this up on an optimistic note, I've seen positive changes in some of the breeds, and I can't say they're permanent, but I've seen, and I won't mention the specific breeds, but I've seen them be responsive to the public just saying, you know, I don't like the way this is going, and I'm going to just withhold participation in this class until you guys kind of change some of the rules and change what you award in the reward in the show ring. And there have been responses to that. So I've seen a little bit of that happening, and I guess the optimist in me says maybe we'll see the same thing with hooves.
I can only hope for the same thing. I have the same concerns you do about certain disciplines and certain classes, and they have made an effort. It isn't throughout the industry yet, but I do see the effort at some shows and see what the judges are starting to reward. And I think they're starting to reward horses that are moving better and moving more soundly. And with the education that we're doing about what causes lameness and the type of movement that a horse is doing and how his foot is hitting the ground, knowing what causes some of these issues, I think is going to really open people's eyes and help turn this back around.
Now, what about farriers that are interested in kind of improving their game, so to speak? How can you help them?
We do a lot of clinics and continuing education events for farriers who want to learn these principles and add that to their toolbox. We also have an 8-week professional farrier school that we run for people who want to become farriers. And we also teach a 5-day barefoot hoof trimming class for people who want to go home and begin trimming hooves, trim their own horses' feet.
You must have been reading my mind. That was exactly the question I was going to ask. If you advocated owners actually taking the rasp themselves and trying to trim their horses' feet.
Absolutely. I've been teaching. I taught at community college in Colorado for several years. I taught beginner farriers, and a lot of people just wanted to trim. They came to the course to trim, and I know people can do it. And I absolutely advocate horse owners who want to trim their own horses' feet, but I want them to get some hands-on instruction, not necessarily from me, but from someone who is experienced, to show them how to safely do it and not harm their horses' feet, not over-trim them, and use the tools efficiently. And that's what we do in our 5-day class.
I would guess that if you were a proactive horse owner that felt comfortable and had the experience, having learned how to do this correctly, you could probably touch up your horse's feet on a weekly basis and not have any huge, you know, like every month having to come in and take off a bunch of hoof.
That's true, because if you have a horse running out on 10,000 acres in the wild, they grind their own feet off a little bit every day. We put them in an environment where they can't do that. So I'm all for horse owners just touching up the edges a little bit here and there and maybe take a loose tag off with a hoof knife. And if you do it on a frequent basis, your horse will never need a full-blown nipper trim.
All righty. Well, thank you so much. My guest has been Patty Stiller. We've been talking about the Equine Lameness Prevention Organization. I bet there is a website where they could learn some more about this.
There is. It's pretty easy to remember. It's www.e-hoofcare.com.
e-hoofcare.com. Patty, thanks so much for being with us.
You're welcome. Thanks for having me.
And there you have it, my friends, Equifest of Kansas, one of the best horse expos in the entire country. You would be surprised how much horse activity there is in Kansas, even more than when I was a kid growing up there in Wichita. It's amazing. We love going there. If you'd like to see where I'm going to be throughout the year, visit thehorseshow.com. Click on that calendar button. I would love to meet you. Have fun, ride safely, and I'll see you next time. For The Horse Show, I'm Rick Lamb.